Hi, this is Rich, and I am the Cisco Collaboration Lead of the PSTS team of Ingram Micro. And today we're just going to be going over a couple of updates and reviews for the Jabber 12 release, the 6841, 6851 phones, and some Q&As from Cisco. So, first, Jabber. Jabber 12 has come out, and we should know the differences from the old one to the new one. So, just going to run over some of the few key features. Number one is it now supports up to 8 lines for the soft phone. The phone also can be deployed in a what's called kind of like a simplistic mode. It's called phone mode with contacts. So it just strips away the I am presence. It strips away the instant messaging, the meeting setups, all this stuff. It just makes it pretty slick and easy. The other new update to it is going to be the turning on and off single number reach. So not only can now the units be adapted to every new situation as it comes at it, but you can even change the single number reach option as well. So in the menu, you can even say, I need to be associated to this single number reach, not this one anymore, and it'll just give you the drop down of all the available numbers. Next is also going to be the Cisco Jabber bots. You can now use these little bots that are created in created using SDK to interact with the instant messaging part of this. So if they get chronic questions of the same nature, the bots can be programmed to just say these sets of responses. If it's anything outside of that scope or it doesn't understand, it will then notify the user saying, hey, this requires your attention, so they can now, you know, give them the answer that's required. Next thing that's on the list is new emojis. Yes, we got 12 new animated emojis. It's amazing. Stop the presses. It's awesome. So you can just get yourself your old nice smiley faces out there and just have a wonderful time with all the emojis. So that is awesome. Next thing on the list is going to be the 6800 series phones. So the 6800 series phones are going to be amazing, especially when it comes to collaboration, because we're probably not going to quote hardly any of them. So the 6800 phones are actually meant not for Cisco phone systems. They're actually meant for third-party phone systems. So this is kind of competing with Polycom. It's kind of also competing with their own SPA series because, I mean, this thing looks way better than any SPA phone. I'm sorry, it just does. So the 41 and the 51 do have just a couple of similarities. So both do have gigabit Ethernet ports, and the then they're also going to support two lines natively. Now this is where everything splits apart. The 41 will not support PoE power. If you look at the data sheet says yes it does and no it doesn't, and yes it does and no it doesn't. Final answer from Cisco, no it doesn't. It does not support any PoE. As a matter of fact, you can't even buy the phone without an AC power adapter. So that's how serious it is. You can't even part it out. So you can buy obviously the power adapter, but you can't buy the phone without it. So all that fun stuff. But beyond that, the 51 can utilize PoE and can also utilize KEM modules. So that's awesome. So you can even expand upon the two-line limitation. You put in two KEMs on a 51. It is recommended, though, if you are pushing it to two KEMs, you might want to throw in an AC power adapter. There's nothing specifically saying that you can't do it all on PoE, but that's a lot of draw, and even on the normal Cisco phones, they usually recommend putting an AC power adapter on there. So I'd rather lean towards the side of caution on this one, especially since there's a lot of kind of misinformation on this phone already. So that is going to be the 6800 series phones. Next on the list is going to be the question and answers sent to Cisco. So the first thing that we asked them about is, hey, the M4s have gone end of life, and these M5s are taking their place. Are there any differences that we should be aware of when it comes to the from the two units? Turns out, yes, there is. Not only is it just better CPUs and different hardware and stuff like that, but there's actual functional differences as well. So we're going to have to kind of keep those in mind, and the collab guide is going to have those notes in there too, but you're going to really find the stuff in the OneNote where I can break it out a little bit better. So first things first, the M4s are going to be going end of sale on March 31st of this year. So that is fast approaching. Next thing is going to be expressway capacity and density. So from the M4s to the M5s, the capacity of the expressway is going to change. It's going to go lower on the 6 and higher on the 7. The exact numbers have not been given out yet, so stay tuned for that. The OVA support also on these servers are going to change as well. So the BE6K servers are, the M5 servers are not going to support medium density OVAs anymore. They're only going to support the small OVAs on the M5s, which is going to is going to reduce the density that the server can support. If they do require a higher scalability or higher density for the actual server itself, we do want to have them consider maybe moving over to the BE7K M5 because that will have the higher capacity on it. The next thing on the servers is the BE6KM, I've been told, will not have a disk drive on it, CD-ROM drive. It might seem kind of petty, but it actually matters if they're going to be doing a CCX. Because when you do the media kits, especially for a new deployment, the media kits are disks, so they install them in there. So if they don't have a disk drive, they're going to have to convert that to USB and then obviously install it that way. So next thing is going to be the differences between the BE4K and the other phone systems. So for the BE4K, is there any recording or call statistics, like how the UC500 worked, how the BE6KS worked? So apparently it does support call detail recordings that can be exported, but the thing is we don't know what it looks like. So I'm going to be working with Mike Mason to see what the details are available in the report and how it appears and how is it done. So that way we're not blind about like, oh yeah, it does reporting. What kind of reporting? I don't know. So I want to make sure I get kind of like a detailed description of what the actual report looks like and what it does. The next one is the Cisco 86851. I know I just talked about it. But it not with it being able to support the 2 KEMs, it can support up to 28 lines in total. The only problem I'm having is I'm not getting a straight answer about what KEM model works with that phone. That's still to be announced. I know it works with one, but there's two different models. Technically three, but the third one's used for voice. Video. So I need to know is it the new one or just the old one that works with the 6800 series phone? And if it's neither, well, what's that part number? So I haven't been getting a really straight answer with that just as yet, but that's my hunt. That's my cross to bear. All right. I wanted to go over having practice versus what we're told to do. So this is in response to the PVDMs. So as far as I was always told, if you have G.711 coming in from your ISP and G.711 coming in from, on your voice over IP network, I was always told you still need at least one PVM to do the translation between the two. So, you know, you got your ISP coming in here and you got your DSP coming through here to then just complete the transaction going back and forth. Well, some folks were told the exact opposite. Some people were told, well, if it has G.711, it'll just come in and go right through the system. Nothing's required. I posted at the Cisco. They still have yet to send me back a response. As a matter of fact, they told me to Talk to Corey. And speaking also about asking Corey, I was also told that for the Cube license SmartNet, I was, well, why do you need SmartNet on Cube licensing? Because it's kind of covered underneath the router, and then cubes themselves aren't even installed onto the routers. They're just pieces of information that says, hey, you're allowed to use this. That's kind of really all it's for. It's mostly for auditing. And that too, yeah, I was told was given to Corey, but they don't have the answer any longer. So that was kind of an interesting answer from them. Next is going to be we're looking at comparisons. My apologies. This is comparisons between the UC500 and the 4K and the BE4K and the BE6K. They say that there is no comparison sheet that exists. The UC500 is obviously a legacy product, but it was loved by most. So, I mean, of course, I mean, a comparison would be reasonable to ask for. But they did strongly suggest to not even bring up that the UC500. They literally said could stir up hard feelings. So that's fun. So I was just going to kind of go over kind of their explanation of the difference. So BE4K solution provides essential IP telephony and for voice centric only customers. It does not offer advanced UC video or contact center or Spark hybrid services options like the BE6K solution. But do note, although the 4K does not support video, soft phones, Spark hybrid services, a client could still select to deploy a 4K for telephony and voicemail, and only and if only needs to utilize Spark solution for their enterprise instant messaging and video meetings without any integration between the two solutions. So that's kind of Cisco's answers for our kind of quick Q&A with them. If you have any questions or you want me to post things to them, or if you're constantly being bugged with something that you just don't know about or you can't find any type of resources on fairly easily, please let me know. Email me, message me, spark me, whatever you want to do. Just let me know, and I'm here to advocate for you. I want to make sure that you can have all the information that you need to be able to do your job smoothly and efficiently. So, this is Richard Huff signing off. Hope you enjoyed this.